Divine Truth Assistance Group. Group assistance sessions putting principles of divine truth into action. This recording is from the Developing My Loving Self group and is part of an Education in Love series. In the Governing Emotions presentation, Jesus defines governing emotions, discusses three groups of governing emotions, shows how governing emotions have a major impact on our lives, and stresses the need to develop a will-based desire to develop faith and release terror. Recorded on the 24th of May 2016 in Noosaville, Queensland, Australia.
Well, this discussion is about governing emotions. You could, I suppose, call them also controlling emotions. When I was quite young in the first century, I realized that the majority of people didn't understand themselves very much at all. In particular, didn't understand how sometimes just one or two emotions being addressed would change their whole life. And as a result, I've also noticed all throughout the last couple of thousand years that, you know, people get to the spirit world, it's the same. Most people don't notice that if they had a scientific way, you know, a scientific method approach to their own emotions, that they would probably firstly address the emotions that control the majority of their life. And so what I notice the majority of you doing is dealing with the emotions that you find the easiest to address first. And this is very, very counterproductive, actually, because usually the emotions you find the easiest to address will have the least effect on your life. And so you're not going to measure a large amount of positive change by addressing only the emotions that you prefer to address. Does that make sense? Yeah. And this is what I've noticed, as I've said throughout my history, is just that most people prefer to address specific emotions because they are, in fact, what they believe are the emotions they're going to be able to cope with, right? Without understanding or having faith in God that actually, no, God made your soul to be able to cope with anything. So there's quite a lot of problems with not understanding that there are certain emotions that have a large impact upon the rest of your existence if you can address them now. And to develop the necessary qualities to address those particular emotions is going to have a great benefit to your life. And my suggestion is spend a lot of time on this material, this governing emotions material. It's very simple to understand, I feel anyway, very simple to understand, but usually most people find it very difficult to put into action. But if you can put it into action, you'll find there is like significant benefits to your life in a very short period, very short time period. All right, so let's discuss what we're going to talk about here with governing emotions. The first thing we need to understand with governing emotions is really that there's three different types of emotion, three different types. So let's look at the three different types. And I don't know if I've called it in the heading, in the outline, that I've called it three groups. So the first group, and for want of a better word, you know, these are let's call the global emotions, not referring to the globe. They're referring to, these are emotions that exist inside one person. So we're calling it global emotions, and I couldn't really come up with a better word because my understanding of the English language isn't good enough to come up with a fancy word for it. But these are the types of emotions that if you change this emotion, your whole life significantly changed from that moment on. Right, these emotions are usually multi-generational. In other words, they've been passed down from generation to generation. over long periods of history. In other words, everyone in society has them, and everyone acts upon them. Right? Now, in each one of these three groups of emotions, there's the positive and the negative expression of these types of emotions. So if I can give an example of a global emotion that's positive. Should we do that first? So we look at the global emotions that are positive. So there's the positive expression of a global emotion. The emotion of faith is like that. So if you develop faith, and particularly faith in God and God's goodness and God's laws, if you develop faith in that those particular things, you'll find that that has a positive effect in every single aspect of your life. Your decisions will change in every single aspect of your life. Every single aspect of your life will change just by developing that one positive global emotion. All right. Does that make sense to you? You can see how that might be the case? Yeah, because now every single thing that comes into your life, you're always trusting God, you're always trusting God's goodness, you're not having doubt and cynicism. You can see how that would have a positive effect in every choice and decision you make. It has a large impact on your life, of course, when that happens. Yeah. Now let's have a look at, a negative one. Negative one. So negative one is living in terror. So you can see how that would have a negative effect on your life all the time. Every decision you make, you're making a choice based on fear. Everything you choose to do, every relationship you engage, all choices based on fear, based on preventing the emotion of terror. Suppressing the emotion of terror. And you see that's going to have a very negative effect on your whole life, isn't it? Every choice you're making, it's always fear that gets considered first. So you can't even be open to considering all the possible opportunities you have while fear is the only thing you're considering first. It's going to have a large effect on your life, negatively. Pretty simple, isn't it, to understand? You can see how those things relate. Yeah. Now, we've got a lot of notes in your outline about that, but you can see that it's pretty simple to understand. There's some examples in your outline about the positive emotions and the negative emotions relating to global emotions, but you can see how they relate, can't you? Okay, is there any questions about that? No. Right, number two. Multiple event emotions. They can also be positive and negative. So let's have a look at a positive, a multiple event. Every time you started crying when you were a child, your parents nursed you but did not mollycoddle you, and they allowed you to finish crying without trying to shut you down. And they just allowed it to happen, and it happened over and over and over again. That's what I'd classify as a multiple positive emotion event. What was reinforced inside of you there is that you can cope with crying. You can cope with pain. You can cope with crying. It's okay to cry. You were allowed to. It was reinforced to you that you're allowed to feel what you feel. Very few of you experienced that as a child. But you can see that if you had have, it would have been a positive multiple event emotion, wouldn't it? It would have a large effect on the rest of your life. Every time you needed to cry, you'd just cry. And you wouldn't judge it, and you wouldn't criticize it, and you wouldn't try to shut it down, and you wouldn't try to run away from it, and you wouldn't try to, you know, get angry with other people about it or anything like that. You'd just do it. Be wonderful. Yeah. So how do I write that down in one line? It's pretty hard, so I'll just leave the A there and you remember that it was a positive. And the negative one. Okay, let's look at a negative multiple event emotion. An example of a negative one is every single time. So this is the direct opposite of what we just suggested. Every single time you started crying, your mother became afraid and she tried to shut you down. And she was nursing you and going, trying to stop you, and she'd feed you and she'd do everything she possibly could to shut you down from crying, including the projection of her emotion. Right? And she did that over and over and over and over again. Does that make sense? So it's a negative multiple event emotion. Yep, so for Eva, thanks.
Yes, and about that, there's another way, and that's to leave your baby crying, maybe shut the door, and you'll cry. The baby will cry until she falls asleep, and that's a good thing.
Yeah, well, that's what they think is a good thing, but yeah, it's not a good thing either, is it? Because that tells you that whenever you cry, you're going to be left alone. Yeah, abandoned. So you're going to have some pretty strong emotional associations with abandonment and tears, aren't you? That's not very good. So you can see that how these multiple event emotions have quite significant effects on even, you know, what you choose to do as an adult now. Because all of these patterns have been established in your childhood. Okay, so that's a multiple event emotion. You've had many of those, right? Many of those. If every time you told the truth you got belted, there's another example. If every time you tried something new you got laughed at, there's another example. Multiple event emotion, negative, going to have a negative effect on your life. Should we go to that?
What happens when it's inconsistent?
It's even worse sometimes when it's inconsistent, because what it does is it develops, in addition to the emotion being developed, it develops the emotion of terror about the inconsistency. So in other words, your life now becomes very inconsistent and becomes very unpredictable. You don't know what mummy or daddy is going to do in any situation under those circumstances. You can't even develop a facade in one direction or another. You know, usually children under those circumstances get quite angry as a result because they don't know how to respond at all. Consistency is far better than inconsistency, obviously. But most parents are very inconsistent, very inconsistent. And what you do with your child there is you confuse them and you cause them to be able to, you know, they're not able to make decisions and choices. They become afraid of even doing anything. And it's also a major way of teaching your child complacency, a desire to not act, a desire to remain ignorant, and so forth. All come from an inconsistent way that a parent treats its child. Yeah. So for example, sometimes you're better off being smacked every time a certain event happened than you were to be smacked one time and not happen and not the other. That's very inconsistent. And even worse would be to be smacked one time and rewarded another. That would be terrible. You know, that causes so much confusion in a child. Of course, the best thing to do would be consistently loved. Of course, that's going to be the best thing. All the others are just bad choices, worse bad choices. Yeah. So yeah, it's very, very difficult when we're treated inconsistently, but. But for those people who've consistently been treated inconsistently, do you get that? If you've been consistently treated one way, one time, and another day, another time, and it's been like that, you're going to find it very, very difficult to make decisions in your adult life. Very difficult. Your will is going to be severely impacted under those circumstances. Yep. Jan, thanks.
Would that inconsistency include if one parent always acted one way and the other always acted the other way?
Yes, that's a little bit more consistent. But what you realise under those circumstances is that the genders get treated differently. So this causes you to believe that men have a certain way of acting and women have another different way of acting and so forth. And you're going to respond one way with men and quite another way with women. And many of you do that too, you know, where if you sit yourself down with a man or a woman in the same situation, many of you will be either angry with the man or angry with the woman, you know, or you know, wary of the man or wary of the woman, but not wary of both. And the main reason why is because there's been this inconsistency in the way that which your mother and the way in which your father have treated you. And of course, some children milk that, don't they? You learn to actually... You through addiction, so up here in the addiction techniques that you have as an adult, you've now learnt through your childhood experience that you can manipulate men this way, but you can't manipulate women that way, right? And so you've got to find a different way to manipulate a woman. And then some children even learn to play one against the other, of course. So this is now the child learning deceitful behaviour, right, which is obviously a very bad thing to teach a child, that deceit should be rewarded. But the child learns deceitful behaviour in the way that it treats one parent versus the way it treats the other. Yep. And that is very much the case because of the codependent, opposite gender, incestuous addictions from the parents. So in other words, the father generally might favour a daughter, a son, you know, mother might favour a son in a modern family. In an old family, oftentimes the father favoured the son and ignored the daughter. You know, it just depends on what kind of codependent addictions were set up in the family as to what the problem will be. Can you see how confusing it is for the poor child? It's like, my goodness, it's amazing any of us survive with any state of, you know, sanity even. Well, most of us, yeah. From God's perspective, we're quite insane, as you can see. And of course, you can see why. Like, you know, you've got to, again, have compassion for that. Many of your illogical decisions are driven completely by the insanities of your childhood that you still have yet to become aware of. And what you believe is bad treatment is only, like, if society believes something between parent and child is bad treatment, then that treatment is even unacceptable by society standards. And that so do you see what I'm saying there? So for example, if this is the society norm of love, right, so society's norm of love, and right up here is God's norm, right, of love, that's what God defines love to be, right up here, you can see that if society views that as unloving, it has to be extremely unloving, doesn't it? Right? So this is our problem, is that when we take on society's view of love, we are only going to see something that's unloving as something that's really, from God's perspective, excessively unloving. Right? And what we believe love is, what we believe is normal, God still feels is quite excessively unloving. And this is why it's very difficult for us, because our whole concept of love, as we learnt in our first sessions, our first group of the assistance groups of this series, we learnt our whole concept of love is so distorted as to be oftentimes God's definition of love completely the opposite to our definition of love. Yeah. So, yeah, and I'd just like to remind you of that, because if society thinks something's normal and then society thinks something else is bad, then what is bad is really, really, really bad from God's perspective generally. But that's not always the case. See, if that's society's view of love, sometimes they think that, which is a higher view of love, not yet God's, but a higher view of love, that is not the norm anymore either. And society will abuse and criticise that. So the key thing you need to be careful of is Is society criticizing you because you're going in that direction, or is society criticizing you because you're going in that direction? That's a problem, isn't it? If we just measure it based on society's criticism of us, then that's not an accurate measure of what's loving and what's not loving either. Because the reality is society does criticize things that are extremely unloving. Right? But what we've got to do is definitely get God's opinion. Otherwise, we're going to be struggle when it comes to society's opinion. Society's opinion is anything outside of this norm is going to be attacked. Right? And by the way, since your parents grew up in society, it's highly likely that their opinion won't be much different to society's. So their opinion of what is normal, their norm, they're only going to allow, again, a certain amount in between that, and other than that, you're going to get attacked. And that's why I've said to you earlier that for the majority of you, you've yet to begin the process of actually working through your facade, because if you had have, already your family would be having a meltdown with you. All right? Okay. So let's look at the third group. Third group is single event. Event. Emotions. Now, example for the positive is can you think of any examples? No. Where somebody has just expressed their gratitude and appreciation for something that you did or a character that you had within yourself. And they just come up and just say, I really love how you do that. And that was just one event. But what that event will do is reinforce a positive emotion inside of yourself. Does that make sense? It's valid. Single event negative emotion might be something like daddy left home when I was little. Single event, dad left home. And it has some negative consequences on us emotionally. We might then believe that daddy left home because he didn't love you, didn't love me, or whatever. And that might not be the case, or it might be the case. But a lot of these single events determine emotions inside of us that then carry on the rest of our lives. Okay. So there's the three groups. So if we go Jada down this side and then Yvonne on this side. So keep your hand up, Yvonne. So Yvonne on this side. Thanks, Jada.
I just had a question with that example.
Mm-hmm.
Like if your dad left home, is that really a single event? Because isn't that almost like affecting your entire childhood?
No.
You're missing out on that interaction.
No. It's only affecting your entire childhood because of the way the person who stays and what she feels about it. Can you see?
Okay.
See, if the person who stays, your mother, is angry about it every time she thinks about it and she's upset with the man and really angry all the time, then that's going to have a severe effect on that child. But if the person who stays still loves a child and daddy still... Even if daddy doesn't visit the child anymore, but the child's reinforced it. No, daddy left because daddy just doesn't know how to love, or daddy and me had big arguments and we couldn't resolve them and he doesn't want to be around me as a result. But why would a father generally leave the family home and still not connect with his child? Well, it's usually because of the attitude of the one who stays. In other words, the attitude of the person who stayed, the mother, and her attitude towards the event, which then the children will... And that's a multiple event based emotion then.
Okay.
So it's the mother's attitude that's reinforced over and over and over and over again. That's a multiple event based emotion. The father leaving is a single event. Interesting, hey? Mm. And if you had worth, if you had a feeling of worth as a child, it wouldn't even bother you at all.
Okay.
Interesting. You wouldn't be bothered by daddy leaving. Who, you know, there's other men around the place, and if dad wants to leave, he can leave. Can you see?
Yeah, kind of.
It's hard to see sometimes when you're in it, see? It's like it's a situation that's happened to you, right? Mm. And so quite often we think it's the person who left that's caused this constant problem for the rest of our life, but actually the reinforcement of the belief didn't usually occur by the person who left. It's actually being driven by the person who stayed.
Okay.
And your father left because your mother has incestuous relationship with younger men, and like she has an incestuous, as I pointed out with your case, your mother has an incestuous relationship with you, which means that she established an emotional incestuous relationship when you came along, and that probably challenged her relationship with her father. So you don't really know why he left. Do you understand?
Mm.
And she won't tell you the truth of why he left because she doesn't know the truth herself of why he left. She will only tell you what she believes to be the truth about why he left. And that's driven by her addictions not getting met by him and so forth, and her anger about that and so forth. And that is a multiple event-based emotion projected at the child over and over and over and over and over again for years and years and years, and that's going to have a huge effect on you.
Yeah.
So the thing that's actually having the higher effect on you is not the fact that dad left. It's what happened as a subsequent result of dad leaving in the family after that point in time. And that was carried on by your mother, not your father. And this is where most of you don't see that actually some of you sort of are really angry with your dads when actually, you know, your mother has created so many of these multiple event emotions inside of you when she was left and your dad only created one. And many of you are thinking, oh, if I deal with my dad, deal with my dad, deal with my dad, this situation will resolve. And it never resolves, no matter how much you try to deal with your dad, because the issue is it didn't come from your dad. It came from your mum. And that's what you got to address. And if you don't address that, then things won't change. So you see, you've got everything up.
It feels so much like it was my dad.
I know. I know what it feels like. Mm. I know what it feels like. But the reality is, you'll come to process some emotion at later stages and you'll realise that, wow, what I've got going on with my mum is a lot bigger than what I got going on with my dad, because dad wasn't there. Mm. So the only thing I got going on with dad was that he wasn't there. But even being told, and your mother, see, I see mothers doing this all the time, reinforcing to their children that daddy left because of the child, or daddy left because he didn't love the child. But really what the mother's doing is avoiding her pain that daddy left, which was a feeling that she wasn't the one he wanted, right? And they're just reinforcing that pain upon the child. And I've seen that happen over and over again historically, particularly in Western societies. Shocking, yeah. And the children grow up feeling that dad's the one that's the bother, when actually it's the mother's rage-based emotions projected at the whole family that have caused the multiple event-based emotions in the child. And as I say, like, the reality is both of your parents could leave. Mm. If you had a sense of worth, it wouldn't bother you at all.
Mm.
So someone didn't give you a sense of worth. Right? Now, I suggest that people who can't give you a sense of worth if they don't have one themselves, but that's a part of that process. But at the end of the day, yeah, you've got to see actually that you can process all you want about your dad, but it's highly likely that you're not going to get rid of this sense of low worth with your dad unless you start looking at your mum's attitude towards your dad.
Okay.
That makes sense?
Mm.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, so single event, and that's why I raised that particular single event-based emotion, because it's one of those things that I see a lot of people going, oh, my dad left when I was little, and so that's had a huge impact on my life. And it's not actually the thing that had a huge impact on your life. It's the emotions of the people who stayed and what they projected at you that has had by far the largest impact upon your life. And those emotions are very bad, very bad. very hard to address, because the person who stays is the person you think you love, and that, and you think that's the person who loved you, and it's very confusing. Very confusing. Yeah, very hard to address. So, you know, this is where understanding these emotions is a bit tricky, because we often think one thing when actually it's the other when it comes to our situation. Yeah. Okay, so we're right up to there. So we can get those things. No more questions about that? Kelly, you want to ask one? Then we can move forward.
I'm just wondering what the emotion is happening when, historically speaking, women keep the children, and it's very rare that when, you know, a man and a woman separate that a man has the children, so a woman...
Well, again, it depends what country you're talking about. If if you're talking about the Middle East, it'd be completely the opposite. But you know, obviously in Western society, that's the case. You know, every country is different based on its unhealed emotional injuries of the country, the society itself. So in Eastern countries, generally, the male keeps the children, not the female, if the female leaves. And so it's very hard for a woman to leave her family under those circumstances, because she's not only leaving her husband, but she also has to leave her children, right? In Western society, it's more acceptable that women take the children than men. And in fact, governments and laws have been made specifically for that to occur, because they believe the mother is more loving than the father, which is also incorrect, right? So... You know, at the end of the day, none of us should have any problems with anybody looking after anybody. But you know, we're so tied into this family concepts that we have this concept in our mind that they're our children, they belong to us. So in, say, Judd's situation, if you had a proper loving authority around, he would have been taken away from both parents. So in the spirit world, Jada would have grown up without a mother or a father, but with a beautiful, loving person who taught him to love himself and taught him to care for himself and taught him that both mum and dad had got issues with love and taught him that they were both wrong. And does that make sense? That's what would have happened. And he might not have seen them for, you know, 50 years, 100 years, 200 years after they've passed, after they've worked out their issues of love, and then he might visit them or whatever. And there'd be nothing wrong with that. Nobody in the spirit world would see anything wrong with that. Right. On earth, we have major meltdown about that. Oh, they've been taken away from their mother and how bad that is, and so forth. It's better to be with their mother. Tristan is working as a social worker in Kingaroy, Tristan being my oldest son, and he says frequently, like, the authorities believe that it's best to leave the child with the parent, no matter what the circumstance is, except when the circumstance is major violence or sexual abuse. And this has got to change, right? If we're ever going to change how much hurt is put on children, this has got to change. So, yeah, it's completely different in the spirit world. A person, like in Judd's case, his mother has a huge amount of anger and rage towards men and has groomed him to become her ideal man. Now that is just as damaging, if not more damaging, than daddy just leaving. Does that make sense? So this is what I'm saying. He would have been removed from both parents in the spirit world.
Thank you.
Rita, thank you.
Would it be even more damaging for the child, for the son, when the mother is deep down in her soul angry with the father?
Yes.
But pretends to be to talk positive about the dad and finds good things. And
yes, very confusing.
Very confusing.
Yeah. Yeah, because on one hand he's receiving all of this anger towards the male gender, of which he is. and at the same time getting a whole lot of words that seem to say anger. So now he's confused about a woman's anger. He doesn't know when a woman's angry, when she's not angry. He's got no way of measuring that. And then on top of that, she is actually angry and she's not owning up to it, so she's lying to him. And he feels the anger and he can't say anything about it because she tells him that she's not. So it's really, really confusing, really confusing. And that's why I'm saying, in the spirit world, they'd be taken away from both parents under those circumstances. If the child would leave, you know, some children won't leave, but if the child is willing to leave, and most children are willing to leave because they hate those kind of circumstances, they'd be taken from both parents. Does that make sense? Yeah. Anyway, rather than getting stuck on that, because we need to get onto the next part of this, which is the main reasons. I've changed the heading, by the way, of the next section. I think you had the major causes of sin. I want to call it the main reasons for sin. And here we're talking about really the main reasons for my sin, why I engage sin. Does that make sense? Okay. So what are the main reasons why I engage sin? Well, there's really two main reasons why I engage sin. And this does apply to the facade conversation we had a few days ago. But the first main reason is our unwillingness to develop a positive global emotion. And that positive global emotion is faith. So let's write it down as an unwillingness to develop faith, the positive global emotion of faith. Now here we're talking about faith in God, faith in God's goodness, faith in God's laws, anything to do related to God and God's goodness, right? Now, can you see why that may cause me to sin? Every single situation that comes up, doesn't matter whether it's violent, not violent, whether it's so-called good or bad, we're in this place here when we have no faith. We're not assessing things based on God's goodness. God is good. You know, God's laws are good. I'm going to try to do what God's laws are. We're not assessing anything based on that. We're only assessing things based on pain and pleasure. That's all. Because we've got no faith. So what we finish up doing is we're going, is this going to bring me personal pain? And it's my definition of personal pain. Or is this going to bring me personal pleasure? And it's my definition of personal pleasure. And so what do? I do one or the other based on my definition of pain and pleasure. But I'm not considering God's goodness, not considering God's laws, not considering that I'm going to have any future reward for a positive choice that's in harmony with love or any of those things. Can you see how that will affect your sin? Can you see it's like you basically throw out any idea of God's laws, any idea of God's goodness, and in the end, what do you finish up doing? You're now basically basing all of your decisions based on a very cynical viewpoint of life that is just all about, am I going to feel good about it or am I going to feel bad about it? And that's it. And that is definitely going to cause you to engage sin. And in fact, in that state, you'll engage whatever you think you need to engage in order to feel good, and whatever you think you need to engage to avoid anything that feels bad. And if that means, on the feeling good side, that means, you know, doing things to other people that harm them, you'll be okay with it. And if, on the feeling bad side, if that means that, you know, somebody might make you feel your life threatened or anything like that, you'll shoot them. You'll kill them. You will. Because the only thing that's deciding what you're going to do is what brings you pleasure or what brings you pain. Right. Without faith, we're sort of left in that place. Faith is such an important quality, a global emotion that we need to develop, a positive thing that we can develop. And it's a global emotion. Once it's developed, it has an effect on every area of your life positively. every area, right? There's no eon developed, so we'll just rub that out. I'm willing to develop faith. Yeah. The second biggest global emotion that has the most powerful effect on your life is to unwillingness. To feel terror as an emotion. If you can fix those two things, you will become loving, like very, very rapidly. And in fact, if you get rid of this one, there's a high likelihood you'll be in the second sphere from that time onwards when you arrive in the spirit world. Everyone in the first sphere is governed by fear. And when you're no longer governed by fear, it has a huge impact on your life. Can you come down to Chris?
I got a question about those two. Don't you need to develop faith to feel your terror?
Yes, you do.
And don't you need to feel your terror to build more faith?
No, you don't.
Okay.
But you do need to do the first.
Okay.
Yeah, you do. Obviously, you need to release terror as an emotion in order to allow the future development of faith beyond that point, certainly. And once you've released terror as an emotion, it will have a very large impact upon your life. And in fact, releasing this global emotion of terror, you can see there's two primary global emotions you've got to release. One is the fear of feeling the emotion of terror, and the other global emotion is the fear of feeling pain. And you release those two global emotions and you're already a long way ahead of any negative events and consequences that may happen, because now your life's not being governed by your terror or fear or fear of pain anymore. So now you have the ability, intellectually, you now have the ability to make choices and decisions which are based on higher things like love and truth and those kind of things. Yeah.
Yeah, so faith is kind of like this thing that doesn't, it's not dependent on feeling your terror.
No, but you will only gain faith by acting upon it and by eventually releasing some terror, you know, over a period of time. So you need to, but you do need to firstly have some faith that terror can be released, obviously.
Yeah. So that's sort of like the spark. That's where it starts.
Yeah, really. The aspiration to develop faith is where a lot of things begin. And that's why Solomon in that message, and I think I've quoted that message in this outline or the next, I can't remember which one, but there's Solomon in his message about what is the most important thing. He said faith on the part of humans and God's love on the part of God. And faith on the part of humans, yeah, it's a personal quality you're going to need to develop. Of course, over time, the more of God's love you receive, the more faith you will have. But you need to begin at a point where you have some faith in God's laws, faith in God's goodness, and you need to develop that faith, develop even aspiration to develop it. You know, remember we said in our first group that most of us don't even have an aspiration to develop it. In fact, our aspiration is to not have it, because we like having doubt and we like having cynicism, because it causes us to not have to act and not have to decide and not have to do the right thing. When we have faith, we now have the feeling that, no, I have to do the right thing. It's a feeling inside of you, not external to you. So, I have to do the right thing because I know God's good and I know God's laws are good. Yeah, it's very positive quality faith.
And that's something that will stay forever, whereas the terror will eventually...
Yeah, that'll disappear.
Yeah.
Yeah. So after you've experienced terror, by the time you've reached the celestial heavens of the spirit world, and you can do that on earth, obviously, by the time you become at one with God, terror will have gone. You won't have it at all.
Still got your faith.
But you still have faith. In fact, your faith will be like a mountain then, you know, you have some... Strong faith. You have a strong faith then. So we start off with a very undeveloped, weak faith, if any faith at all. We're usually in doubt and cynicism and all those kind of things, which the world loves, because the world loves doubt and cynicism because doubt and cynicism cause inaction. It means that you're not going to act, you're not going to change. And none of the world wants you to change in opposition to the world. So of course they're going to oppose the development of faith and also at the same time oppose the release of terror. This is where you're going to find your biggest opposition from the world. You're going to find your faith being attacked all the time, pulled down all the time, people making, you know, those little innuendos at you all the time. Oh, do you really think this is? And do you really think this? And, you know, it's all just suggestion to try to get you out of having some faith. And it's all spirit manipulated and people manipulated based on their own desires and their own opinions and their own unloving behaviour. And honestly, most of you fall victim to it still, you know, like particularly when it comes to me. Do you really think he's Jesus? I don't know if he's really. Why are you listening to him if he's not Jesus? I don't really know. Whereas all you have to do is assess whether what I'm saying is loving or not, isn't it? You don't have to really know who I am. You just need to know whether what I'm saying is loving or not. But see, these innuendos cause you to go, maybe I shouldn't listen, which is exactly what the goal is, isn't it? To prevent a person from developing these qualities. Yeah. So go to Rick up the back, thanks.
In the beginning, can you just choose to have faith?
When you say choose, Rick, it's got to be a soul-based choice, and this is where most of us struggle because most of us actually are making soul-based choices to doubt. We want to doubt because it means that we don't have to act, we don't have to do something, we don't have to take positive action. So developing faith, remember faith is a soul-based quality and it can't be willpowered. You can't willpower yourself into faith. You have to develop the aspiration for it, and that's by educating yourself. And the way you educate yourself is you educate yourself about God, educate yourself about God's goodness, educate yourself about God's laws. You try a few experiments, you know, where you experiment with God's laws and God's goodness and so forth, and you get some responses there. So that builds your faith in God's laws and God's goodness. And now the quality of faith is being developed in your heart, you know, in your soul, not just in your head. And once your heart starts feeling the quality of faith, now you've got a motivation. Now that can govern your choices and decisions. So it has to be a process that is a soul-based process. It's not something that you can sort of heavy your way through or willpower yourself into, but you need to develop an aspiration to work through the issues that cause you to have a lack of faith. And that means removing things like cynicism and doubt, and seeing cynicism and doubt as a choice rather than an excuse. You know, we use it as an excuse generally rather than just seeing it as a choice. It's a choice to not act and a choice to not do the right thing. And so we need to address those particular emotions. So there is an emotional process that you'll have to go through to develop faith, but you can do that independent of terror. And in fact, you're going to need to do it independent of terror before you'll feel your terror, probably. Yeah.
Can I just ask?
Yeah, fire away.
So if someone has no faith in an area, then basically they just need to start to act.
No, they need to educate themselves first, develop the aspiration first. Acting, forcing yourself to act upon something that you don't have faith in is really a false action. You know, it's like acting falsely. What you need to do. Yeah, and so, you know, the whole New Age sort of concept of, you know, just do something over and over and over until it feels normal is not really apply here. What you need to do is educate yourself. You need to gain an education about, in particular on what I'm recommending here, is an education about God, God's laws, God's goodness, and experiment with that. You need to develop an aspiration to do that inside of yourself, a desire to do that, develop that, and then you'll have some faith. So it's not about, and then you will act after that. You know, but you need to first take action in the area of developing the aspiration, which is all about allowing the concept that God's goodness exists, that God itself exists, God's goodness exists, God's laws exist, they're all good, they're all loving, and I just don't understand them type of thing. And allowing those thoughts and feelings and educating yourself by reading material that supports that belief. And then once that belief is established in your heart, now you'll find acting in faith much more It's easy then to act in faith.
Excellent, thank you.
Yep. All right, well, let's move on because there's a fair bit to cover here and I'm already. I'll just check my time. Okay. Okay, well, I got to get a move on. So let's go here. Now, I want to talk to you just briefly about the two diagrams I've done in this particular outline, because it's really important that your concept of your current, you know, your soul-based condition as it stands right now changes, because even your concept of your soul-based condition is completely false. It's actually completely different to your actual condition. And what we need to do is see how pain is having an influence in our life and our beliefs about pain and what kind of influences those particular beliefs are having. So this section is all about examining my false beliefs about pain. So this is still part of that second section, you know, the issue of terror, of feeling emotion. But let's look at the contrast. Imagine this is our soul, right? Most of us believe that our current pain is just a little bit up the top here. You know, we believe that, yeah, we're in a bit of pain, but it's not that much, and, you know, with a few pills here and a bit of alcohol there and some nice people around me, it goes away, and as long as I look after myself generally. Then we have this whole huge concept, right, of terror, the thing to avoid, right? And the pain of terror, we just think is like, oh, humongous, you know? It's huge. Isn't that how we see most things? We just think it's so big, can't deal with it, never going to be addressed, never going to be addressed, never can be addressed, it's pointless to address it. Try to ignore it and live out the rest of our life the best we can. And then we examine the issue of our childhood pain, you know, the real causal pain that once it's released will change our lives. And we think that, you know, most of us think that's small, quite small, you know, like, yeah, my mum and dad, you know, they're occasionally no good, but, you know, that's every parent, every family has that experience, you know. We had a good life, relatively good life growing up, and everything's really quite fine, and I haven't got that many problems. You know, that's how we see it from our childhood. That's basically how we see our soul. So can you see the problem with that? The problem with that, seeing our soul this way, is that this part here becomes the dominant. You know, we're not actually considering why is it that we have such a big area there. But that becomes the dominant thing in our life. It becomes the dominant thing that causes us to make choices and decisions. It governs our entire life, right? So that's our view of where we're at. That's how we see it. Completely false. It's not how it actually is from God's perspective. How it actually is from God's perspective is very interesting, because if we take the same soul, the current pain from God's perspective is the biggest thing. In other words, God's basically saying to you that the pain you're in right now is the worst it's going to get unless you, as long as you stop sinning. But if you keep sinning, it's just going to get bigger. So that's what God's really saying to us. And this is what happens, is we sin some more, and what happens? It's bigger. And we sin some more, what happens? It's bigger. Sin some more. You can see what's happening. Bigger. more and more pain, more and more pain, less of other things, more pain, the more we sin. Right? And we think our current pain's only that big, you know, it's only little, it's not too bad, I can manage it. Right? You're going to die from it. I wouldn't call that managing it. Would you? If we go to Paul. Thanks, up the back.
So I'm wondering if you can measure pain, whether this is actually what's happening or whether this is sort of in our mind.
This is in our mind.
Yep.
This is and also to a large degree in our feelings too. We believe this is the truth. We believe the worst thing that we can experience is terror. That's what we believe. And we believe that our current pain is better than experiencing anything else. Can you see? Because it's the less of all three. We see, well, if I'm only in this amount of current pain, right, and the terror is that big, I don't want to feel that. And childhood pain is that big, I don't want to feel that. And I'm only in this amount of current pain, then it means I shouldn't deal with anything. Can you see? It means that the best possible course of action about my pain is no action. This is why we have a lack of faith, really. It's because we believe false things. We believe that this is true. So this, we're accepting this as truth, you know. That's the problem. We think that, well, my current pain's manageable. But if I go into my terror, that will be unmanageable. And if I go and do my terror as well as my childhood pain, that'll be intensely unmanageable. Right? And this is all to do with our false belief systems. And so what we do is we go, my best course of action under these circumstances, if this is true, my best course of action is to not deal with any of it, which is the reason why most people on the planet never deal with any of it. Can you see? That's what we believe. Right? But actually, from God's perspective, this is true. Your current pain, from God's perspective, is the biggest thing and getting bigger by the moment. And it makes sense to address it by addressing its causes. Pain, the refusal to address pain, remember, and the refusal to address the emotion of terror is what creates our facade, and therefore all of our further sin, our pain. If we address these two particular issues, pain and terror, as emotions, we address these two particular issues, this will all disappear. Our cup will be full of love and truth and other things after that. Right? But the problem is, we think, no, this isn't true. See, to God, the emotion of terror, like, is pretty small. You think it's the worst thing you're going to have to experience. And from God's perspective, it's pretty small. And your childhood pain, for most of you on this planet at this stage, is pretty small. You go back 500, 1,000 years, and it's not the same for everyone, of course, but you go back 500,000 years, the pain of people was bigger. It was. Like, there was a lot more violence in the world, a lot more oppression, particularly oppression of different races and genders. And, yeah, it was worse. But at the moment, your current pain is, like, is the worst thing you've got. But you don't believe it. While you don't believe it, you're probably not going to do anything about it. Can you see? So I wanted to draw that diagram because what I'm trying to illustrate to you is that your current belief about your current state is actually so false from God's perspective. Your current state, the law of compensation has created your current state. Your current state is the worst it can be unless you keep sinning. And if you keep sinning, it's not the worst it can be. It's going to get worse. Does that make sense? Confusion now reigns. Karen, you're going to go.
Is the current pain, is it bigger than I think it is, or is that right-hand cup much smaller?
No, your current pain is far bigger than you think it is.
Right.
Far bigger than you think it is. It's killing you. Most of you don't believe that it's killing you, but it is. And when you get to 100 years of age, if you make it, you'll realise it's killing you. Yeah, your current pain is pretty big. It's the result of the sin. These things that are the causes of sin can easily be dealt with, right? But you think it's going to be worse dealing with that. So what I'm trying to get across, I still feel most of you a bit confused about this. And it's really important that you understand it. See, God's perspective of your current pain is the worst pain that you're going to ever experience unless you keep sinning. If you keep sinning, it's going to get worse. Right? And what causes you to keep sinning, which are these two things, are less than even the current pain you're in. Dealing with them is going to be less traumatic. And if you think about it logically, of course that makes sense. Many of you have had 20, 30, 40, 50, 60, 70 years creating sin, right? Therefore creating more pain. These things happened within 7. This happened usually shortly after the moment of conception into your first few years. This happened over the rest of your life. So which one naturally has to be bigger? That has to be bigger, doesn't it? But we want to see it as smaller, and we think we want to see these other things as bigger, and therefore we want to see them as it's better to not touch them, it's better to not deal with them, it's better to not do them, it's better to not process them. That's how we see it. Karen?
I think never far from my mind is that story of Mari and the Harvest of Jealousy chapter.
Yep.
She had an enormous amount of pain for a long time after she died.
Yep. That was the pain she was in currently because of her sin. That was what she created. It wasn't. If she had allowed herself to feel her original pain, so in other words, if she'd allowed herself to cry about a man leaving her, which she refused to do, she would have been over it in a few years. But she didn't. You know what she chose to do instead? She chose to engage in like deceitful conduct. She was even prepared to murder her, you know, the other woman, and so forth. Now, what's she doing? So instead of feeling the original pain, which is actually quite small, her original pain was really just quite small. Instead of feeling it, she chose to avoid feeling it, and what did she create instead? A whole heap of new sin, right? And therefore a mountain, which she now will need to process.
So when she was on earth, she wasn't aware of how much pain she was in?
Yeah, she was. She felt the pain when the guy married her best friend.
Okay.
She felt the pain, but what did she choose to do?
I'll stay there.
No, she chose to revenge. She chose revenge.
Yeah.
Right? She plotted revenge for years, 4 or 5 years, according to her own explanation.
And lived in the pain.
She lived in the pain without feeling it. Instead of feeling the original pain.
Yeah.
She suppressed the original pain, which was just the hurt of somebody leaving her, right? And instead of doing that, she chose to sin. And that caused a huge amount of pain and the harvest of jealousy. That when Nephra relates the experience, you get to see the experience. But all of that was avoidable if she'd only seen the original pain as something she could feel. Do you see?
Yeah.
So she created that.
Yeah, I think partly, like, I'm not aware of a huge amount of pain now, but I'm very frightened of a huge amount of pain after I die. That's all. So.
Well, many of you fall into that category, but the reality is that's because you've desensitized yourself to pain.
Right.
Yep. Yeah. You've desensitized yourself by doing this, by saying, it's not like that. It's like this. It's like that. I'm only in a little bit. I've only created a little bit. I've only done a little bit of sinning, and so I've got to be fine.
Yeah, it's the desensitizing bit that I...
Yeah, that process of transforming how God sees you, this is how God sees you, so this is God's viewpoint, into how you see you. Right? Can only occur through a desensitization process.
Yep.
Right? We're not sensitive to the outcome of our sin. And in the spirit world, God's not going to allow you to be desensitized to the outcome of your sin.
Yep.
So it's far better to become sensitive to the outcome of your sin now. And what I'm saying is that is a reversal of that process. In other words, what you've got to do is instead of trying to make out that your current pain is like that, you need to start to see what's actually happened. And what's actually happened is it's actually that big. You've created a lot of sin in your life. The older you are, the more you've created. And therefore, the more pain there's going to be once you're sensitive to it.
Yeah.
Yeah. That make sense?
Yes.
So this is how God sees it. But the reason why I'm pointing that out is that actually the current pain you're in is actually going to be, is the worst thing that you're going to experience. The lady in the Afra book, as you mentioned, in the Harvest of Jealousy, the pain she was in was the worst pain she was experiencing because she was having to go over and over and over again all the choices she made about sin when she could have chosen just to cry about the guy marrying her best friend.
Yep.
She could have chosen to do that. And she didn't. Just that one thing.
Yeah.
And she was 20 years in the hells, another 20 years in the place, still in darkness, in the place where the book describes her, crying, re-experiencing the situation over and over again, but still not even yet getting to her childhood pain, the reason why she did it. And that's why she was there, until she had to keep telling a story, keep telling a story, keep telling a story, until such a point in time that eventually she got to the childhood emotion that caused her to make these decisions. And then she's had an awakening to sin. Do you follow?
Mm.
Yeah. That's why it's an emotional process for her. Now, this is one of these subjects that we need sort of like 50 hours on, right? But we're not going to get 50 hours, are we? We're going to get hardly any more time on it. So what we'll do is, I think the best thing to do is have a break for 10 minutes and then we'll have to have a fairly short Q&A about it as well. But I really haven't said everything I'd like to say about this particular section, but you start to get a picture of what you need to understand with regard to these emotions, and what we'll do next is have a Q&A about that subject. So let's come back at 5:02, 5:02, 1.